Okay, our next speaker is Luis Gomez. He's from Peru. Luis came with Jeff Mon to WSU last year to look at our small breeding program, and it was very nice. I think she was a little overgenerous by saying how things look here. Luis has a fantastic breeding program in Peru, and really look forward to hearing more about it now today. So no further ado, we'll let Luis take
it. I will try. Okay. I know that the first language of Quinoa was Quechua and Aymara. So 500 years take time to learn Spanish. Now it's learning other language, among them English. So I will try to make my presentation in English. Excuse me if I have some bad pronunciation. In the first place, I want to give my thanks to Dr. Murphy and the organization committee for inviting me to present you the work that we are doing in the National Agrarian University in Quinoa. We are a very small group, but we are trying to do something for developing quinoa in Peru. So I think it's very important that I must give you a general introduction about how is quinoa in Peru in the past and in the present. And so you will have an idea about the work that we are doing. So we know that Peru and Bolivia is where we can find the higher biodiversity of quinoa in this area. And there are many evidences about the domestication of this crop in this region. So for Peru, the oldest remains of quinoa was found in Ayacucho, here in the southern part of Peru. It was in the cultura Huari before the Inca time. So the years of this grain of quinoa is more than 4,500. And in the ceramic of Peru, I think it's very hard to find quinoa representation. We have many representation of many crops in the ceramics in Peru. But this is the only, you can see here, the grains of quinoa is represented in this ceremonial cup of the cultura Huari. So we can say that quinoa, according to many researchers, quinoa was a main crop in Peru before the Spanish conquered my country, together with maize, potato. It was the food for more than 50 million persons in this time. So it was, I think, growing in huge areas. But when the Spanish people arrived to Peru, they brought these crops: barley, wheat, broad beans, fava beans, peas, and oats. And you could see now how looks the Andes in Peru. About 3,000 meters, we have grown these crops. And I think that it was not I personally can believe that it was not prohibited by the Spanish. It was that this crop conquered the land of the Andes, because you could see these crops that was brought for the Spanish was a main food of them. And after, they have a very good adaptation in the marginal land of the Andes. Barley is the last crop growing above 4,000 meters of sea level, and is the main food of many poor people in the Andes. And also, the technology for growing barley is very easy. The farmer throw the seed, cover the seed, and after 4 or 5 months, harvest the barley. And they are, harvesting more than one ton of seed, 1,000 kilograms, no? So also it's very easy to use in food and to keep the grains for the next season. So this is the reason that I believe personally that quinoa surface was reducing in the time in Peru. We can see this data. I think it's very important. We have here wheat, fava beans, barley, peas, and I think the four of them. Now, in this time, in 2011, they are growing in more than 400,000 hectares in Peru, in the highland of Peru, above 3,000 meters of sea level. I believe that was the area of quinoa in the past. Now we need to increase the land of quinoa, but we cannot replace this crop. It will be very hard to replace this crop because it's part of the Andes farming system also. This is a historical series of quinoa surface in cultivating Peru from 1951 to 2011. You could see in this year we have more than 40,000 hectares of quinoa growing in that time. The small area was reported in 1992 with a little 7,000 hectares. So with the new revolution of quinoa, we are starting growing again the area. So this is the official data for 2011. We are growing more than 35,000 hectares. I think in this last season, we are growing near to 40,000. What happened with the yield that is more important? The yield is, you could see, we have the highest yield in 1959. Now in this last year, we are almost reaching this yield. That means that also we have the lowest yield in 1971. So you could see the picture in yielding is almost the same than 50 years ago. The main reason, personally, I believe that we are using the oldest cultivar that was selected by the farmer. We need to improve or to produce new cultivars for Peruvian to have two or three times more yield in the same area. So this, the quinoa is growing in two main areas in Peru. In the highland, around the Titicaca Lake in Puno, we have 80% of our surface and production. In the rest of the highland, we call the Valley Highland, we could see that we have only near to 20% of the surface. The environment in this area is very difficult, it's very marginal. We are talking of farming about near to 4,000 meters. In this area, we can have a very nice valley with very good weather, a very good land. So the yield of quinoa here is lower than this area. And we are starting growing quinoa in the coast along the Pacific Ocean. Here in Arequipa, we are in this last year harvesting 4 tons per hectare. So quinoa was important staple food for the Peruvian people before the Spanish, but it was only kept for centuries in the altiplano. But in the rest of Peru, there are many places in Peru now that the people, the farmers, they don't know quinoa. They don't know how to grow quinoa. They don't know how to eat quinoa. So we lost a lot of. We have a cultural and genetic erosion in Peru. We started worrying about quinoa in the same way than Bolivia and other countries around the 60s. So I think the reason that quinoa is important now because it was the nutritive value that bring again quinoa, especially I think because had a good market in the vegetarian people and the people that like organic food. And now we know that also has a very nice agronomic quality to grow in marginal lands. I believe that will be a very good option for the climatic change. Quinoa use mainly the grains directly. The biggest grain we use a pearled grain. The small one we made flour flakes. And also we have different kinds of quinoa. One of them pop like the maize, so we can make a popped grain. And also we are developing some beverage, especially I think they are doing in the south part of Peru, quinoa milk. We are using also the leaves, especially when the plant is very young. So we are using like spinach. Also the people use dried and grounded and can keep for a long time. And also we are using the biomass like fodder. And also in the traditional costume of our farmer, they use the ash when they are chewing coca leaves. This is the price of quinoa from 1994 to 2011. I didn't change this. So you could see that the price at national level really is increasing from this time. We have here some region or departments in Peru that they are important in growing quinoa. And also we have here two departments here, Huancavelica and Junín, where we are growing our experimental field and we are working with the farmers. So the price is very interesting for the farmer. They start thinking to seed quinoa. So there are a good market in the outside quinoa, outside Peru, excuse me. We can see here the destination of quinoa from 2007 to 2011. You could see that United States is the biggest market for quinoa. 60% of our production is coming to US, and also we have Germany and Canada, the biggest buyer of quinoa. This is the value you could see is increasing. Also the amount of quinoa that is selling outside of Peru is increasing and the price. So it's very interesting crop for the farmers. This is the general distribution of quinoa production in Peru. You can see here we have Puno, the more important department in quinoa production. So 50% is used in auto consumption, 35 in the domestic market, and 50% is outside in the international market. So I think the amount is similar in different departments. This is the national average. So we are keeping at the farmer house, we can say 12% of the production, 47 is for the domestic market, and 41% for the international market. This is the distribution. But here I want, I love my country, I love the farmer, I work for them. So I am really worried because the tendency in my country is to sell quinoa outside of Peru. In this time, the price of quinoa is so high in Peru that only the people that has good economy can buy quinoa, because there are so much people in Peru that they cannot afford to buy 1 kilogram of quinoa. And we have a problem with malnutrition in Peru. You could see here in the highland, you could see here barley and wheat growing mainly. So you could see here that we have 7 million people living mainly from farming and related activities in the Peruvian highland. In this condition, the yield and quality of the crops are very low, and sometimes the fields yield only enough for family consumption, which creates problems like malnutrition and poverty. You could see here the data that we have of in small children below 5 years old, high problem of malnutrition, 45% of malnutrition in some areas, and also in the urban place, we have problem with malnutrition. So I feel that we need to increase the production of quinoa. So I dream that we can have so much supply that quinoa price can go down. And I know that they say, but the farmer, they will lose. They want to lose because they can harvest 2 or 3 times. I think that they can have more rentability for the amount, not for the price. So this is the reason that we are trying to increase, to collaborate with my government, because I am working in National University. We are trying to develop a new cultivar to improve the production technology. And in these two subjects, maybe is a little more harder, but we are also trying to develop new cultivars for new areas. And I think, I hope that my government will keep the policies necessary to protect the farming in the highland. So what we are doing in my university, we work in 3 locations. You could see we have different altitudes, 2,700, 3,200 above sea level, and in our campus that is near to the sea, 240 meters above sea level. So we have a very good environment because we work 2 seasons during the year. So we move quinoa from the Andes to the coast and each year. So this is the reason that we can have cultivars for the coast of Peru. What we are looking, we are trying to develop new cultivars, but keeping the high adaptation that quinoa has to marginal condition, especially. We are trying to improve the resistance and tolerance to biotic and abiotic stresses. We are looking for higher yield, for quality, in the first place for food and after for the industry. The methodology that we are using is we make a germoplasm collection and evaluation. I think it's the first step. We are doing massal selection, individual selection, but we are using also mutation induction in our breeding work. So this is the germoplasm. I know that you must want this nice germoplasm. We have more than 3,000 accessions, but we evaluate already for some characteristics 2,085 accessions. They were collected in Peru, in all the highlands of Peru. Puno is the, we have the higher diversity, but also in other parts of the highlands, we have also a good amount of accession. I will show you, we made morphological characterization. We use the descriptors. So we evaluate for 15 characteristics. Also we do agronomic characterization, especially life cycle, plant height, lodging, and preliminary yield potential. We study the response to disease and also to abiotic stresses. You could see this marginal land. We can see here the drought tolerance, the salt tolerance of quinoa. In this collection, we are also evaluating the quality characteristics, especially protein content, saponin content, and we are evaluating also the size of the grain. So I will show you a small example about the higher biodiversity that exists in this small sample. 85 accession of the collection, we took 50 accession from the, we call the quinoa valley ecotype, and altiplano ecotype from different parts, 35. And in the valley group, we found two groups that the major difference among these groups are the plant height, the maturity, and the grain yield. It was because protein and saponin, they are almost similar in this group. And also we found some source of resistance to mildew, that is the main disease in Peru. For the altiplano group, we found also two groups that you could see also protein and saponin. There are similar content, but the major difference in this group was the grain yield potential in this material. So we have here a mean value comparing the 50 valley ecotypes and the 30 altiplano ecotypes. Here for flowering time, you could see the valley type is longer cycle. The plant height also in the valley type, there are huge plants. Sometimes we are having two meters or 3 meters higher, and when we move to the coast, get more higher. Here we have the maturity. Also, you could see the valley type. They have long life cycle. And here for the mildew, we could see that the valley type in average is more tolerant to mildew. Here we can find, in this group, we found a minimum value of 20% of this disease in the leaves. And for yield, you could see that the more yielding types is from the valley place. If we could see here the minimum value that we found in the altiplano is 160 kilograms per hectare, and the highest was 2,900 kilograms. And in the valley, also we found a very low yield, but also a very high yield, more than 3 tons per hectare. For protein content, there are similar value in both groups. Also, we have, you could see the highest value in this group is 17%, but in our collection, we have a genotype that has 24% of protein content. For saponin, we found also a quinoa without saponin and quinoa with a high amount of saponin in both groups. In this picture, you could see that they are only phenotyping the material, we can find the difference among the valley ecotype and the altiplano ecotype. I believe that they have a different evolution, so we can think that we have different genes for many different aspects for breeding program in these two important sources of quinoa in Peru. So in our evaluation, we found very positive qualities of traditional cultivar, like adaptation to adverse environment, high nutritive value, resistance and tolerance to disease, agronomic characteristics and they are adapted to the use that a farmer can give to quinoa. But we found also like tall plants, long life cycle, branching plant habits that is not good for harvesting with combine, susceptible to shattering, susceptible to mildew and other disease. So this is the reason that we decide to apply mutation induction, because we have a good qualities, but we need to change only like the life cycle, plant height to have very nice crops, a very, very nice cultivar. So we follow this step that is a traditional protocols applied in mutation induction. We are using this amount of gamma ray from 150 to 350 gray. We made evaluation for different traits. Also, we apply some treatment with for drought tolerance to reduce the population. And after, when we select the baseline, we are doing agronomic yield trials in different locations. So we are almost here. We will release 3 cultivars the next year that we got by this technology. You could see this is what showed me that the mutation induction is working. This is Pasancaya, a very nice cultivar in Peru, but it has not good adaptation to the valley because this is very early, so much early that the farmers need to grow with rain. It's not good, it's not accepted by the farmer. And this is the chain that we found, different chain in morphology, in life cycles, in this cultivar. And also we work with other cultivar, we call La Molina 89. So we found that you could see this chain. So we were sure that we have already mutation working in this material. We find also dwarf plants among these populations. So I think will be very useful to make crops in the future with the highest taller plants that we have in our collection. And we change also the color of the grain. You could see this is the natural original color of Pasancaya, and we bought this white one and the black one. I didn't find the picture I was looking. I forgot in my country, because also we have in this quality black grain from this cultivar. We test for saponin content. So you could see this is the parent line with this. In this, we measure the height of the foam to know the amount of saponin. And you could see here, this is the parent line. And we have a higher saponin content in the mutant lines, but also we have a lower content of saponin in this population. It was 900 lines that we made evaluation for this. Also for a protein content, this is the parent material with 17% of protein content. But also we found these 3 lines. This is equal to the parent material. They are a little higher than the parent material. So what we are trying to have for the farmer is this mutant, this kind of population. This is the last step of the mutant. You could see the farmer, they won't find defect. Because what we are trying to look in this plant is we call the micro mutation that can change the yield, can change the saponin content, and can change the protein content, but to keep the plant beautiful. So the farmer, they can accept easily this material. And the more important thing is the yield. You could see here, we are with this line, we are 4 tons. And we are keeping the amount of protein. Some of them is 14% in average, other one is 17% of protein. And here this the other population also with black grains and white grains. So also we have a very good potential with this material. Also we are doing, we are trying to increase the land of quinoa in Peru. The only way where we can do is to develop new cultivar for the coast of Peru. We can see here, this is the, we have problem in the coast of Peru. We have more than 300,000 hectares with salinity problems. And in the coast of Peru, we have a shortage of water irrigation. We don't have, it's a desert. All the coast of Peru is a small desert. We have only farming where the river of the highland arrived. So we have problem with irrigation. So quinoa is a good option because can use little water and could be also a very good option for rotation with the horticulture crops that is growing in the coast. In the coast, we have a very high technology, especially for the horticulture crops. So we start making evaluation of quinoa. In the first step, we make a evaluation about the germination. How is the germination in salinity? So you could see here we have a, this is the check. We use four dose. This is the 30 and 40 electricity conductivity of 16 semen. So you could see that there are some lines that is still had a good germination. Also with the 25 semen of salinity. So from this 146 that we made evaluation, we pick up or select 15 accession that we start growing. Using all the life cycle, we use 400 millimoles of salt. After, when we harvest the quinoa, the soil was destroyed, but quinoa gave grains. You could see here, this is the greenhouse where we are, we did this study and we harvest quinoa grain with this high amount of salt. So we are thinking that maybe in the future, also quinoa can grow with the, I think the salinity of the sea is 300 millimoles. We are growing quinoa with 400 millimoles. So you could see there is a very tolerant to salt. Okay, this is the breeding program, but you know, the breeder must take the cultivar to the farmer. So we need to develop also technologies for growing or improved cultivar. So this is a picture that we can find in the highlands of Peru, especially in the valley. You could see here is fava beans that was brought for the Spanish. This is a line of quinoa. This is maize, the main food, the main crop, and one row of quinoa. This was the picture maybe until 10 years ago. So the farmer didn't have any problem, can keep care personally of each plant. But after that, we are in Puno and in other department, we have monoculture, but the area was small. But now the area is increasing and the problem is increasing. So we are trying to, we work with the farmer. We work with 8 communities in the highland. So all of what I am telling you is what we are doing with the farmer. So we are trying to keep the way that they are feeding quinoa, but we are trying also to use it some, especially in the coast. We developed this small, a small box to seed. It's very nice, give a good density. Also, this small machinery that is used for horticulture crops, and we can have this kind of population in the beginning. But also we are working with irrigation system. We are doing transplanting. We are transplanting quinoa. So usually we can use in that traditional system, the amount of quinoa is maybe from 15 to 20 kilograms per hectare. This is the amount of seed that we use. But with transplanting, 1 kilogram is enough for 1 hectare. And also the advantages of this system is that we don't have weeds, problem of weeds among the lines of quinoa. So this is very important because, you know, we don't have any herbicide to apply to control weeds in quinoa. Everything must be made by hand. We are trying to increase the amount of plants in the rows, so we study one row, two rows, to have a better density. We make some observation about how this amount affects the size of the grain, especially, and the yield. So also we are doing organic and inorganic crop system to show the farmer how to use some product. We can see that always with the inorganic or the conventional system, I can say better, with the conventional system, we can have better yield. This is the organic system, but still the farmer can have a rentability with both system, because in the organic system, the price is very high, and in the inorganic or conventional system, the amount of yield can give rentability to the farmer. Also, this is the proportion of the expenses in the system. You could see the hand labor and the agriculture inputs is the how is is. The farmer spend more money in these in using a lot of hand labor because almost many practical labor in the cultivation of quinoa is made by hand. And here we have also the amount of organic input is also more expensive for the farmer. We are also working with comparing in the organic system two sources of fertilizer, island manure. You know, Peru in front of the coast, we have a manure of birds that is very rich. So we are trying to use this fertilizer and also the farm manure. And we are working with I think a more genotype, but this is the example that I am trying to show you. So you could see that yield is getting better with the in the organic system with the correct use of fertilizer, comparing with the traditional system of the farmer. This is the work is made in farmer fields. Also, we are trying to improve the harvest system because in general, you could see everything is made by hand. They pick up some stones and they start using in this way harvest the quinoa. And also, we are trying to introduce some small harvesting machinery, but also in some valleys of Peru, they have combined to harvest barley and wheat, and they can use without any problem this kind of combine. You could see here, we are harvesting in my farm, experimental farm in the university. We are harvesting quinoa with the combine. So everything that I told you, excuse my English, we show to the farmer. We are working very close with the farmers in different locations of Peru. They are visiting our fields so they can participate in the work. And also, I think you are invited. We will be giving in this next 2 months a practical way to grow quinoa in La Molina in 2 days. So if you want to see directly, to weed, to make all the practical, you can go to Peru. So for the future, what we are thinking to do in the future to improve the resistance to disease and to insects, because I know that you are growing quinoa and you know that it's a big problem, the disease and the insect, and will increase when you will increase the area of production. So we need to improve this resistance. And also we are working still because we have more than 2,000 accessions. So we are looking for sun, low and high temperature, for drought tolerance in our material. And also we are starting a work with molecular marker, and maybe in the future we will have the marker assisted breeding in quinoa in Peru with the help of the Jeff and Rick, that they are helping us in this subject. We are doing, we think that we need to improve still the crop technology, and also we need to have more creation to develop more products for quinoa in the future. So all our work has the support of Inca Agro, the International Atomic Energy Agency, CONCITEC, the Belgian universities and BIU, and the industry. Alicorp is a big industry in Peru and is helping me for the second year that I have help of this industry, and it's very nice because all my work was made in the beginning very small, in very small area with very few people. So I think that in the future, we will have more quinoa growing here and more children having better food. Thank you.